Yeah, right?
Yes.
Deal?
Boing.
Welcome to the Acquia Podcast, Drupal technology, community, and business.
Welcome to the Acquia Podcast, Drupal technology, community, and business.
There's a module for that?
There, of course there is.
I am with Larry Garfield at DrupalCon Amsterdam. So if we accept that our three value adds are flexibility and extensibility, mm-hmm. and then everything around content, mm-hmm. so either ingesting or creating content, managing it, displaying it, access, all of that functionality, mm-hmm. and the community, how do we define, do we need to define what is the Drupal community, and how do we keep a really great group of people together over the next, let's say, 5 years, when they're not tied to, we're not the community that's tied to hook help, hook form alter, this bunch of code that we've thought about. I think a lot of us thought Drupal is this code, mm-hmm. and we just happen to be working together. How do we get to the point of thinking, we're a great bunch of people who like doing cool stuff together. Let's do this stuff and... Because Drupal itself, right, is kind of amorphous.
And that gets to some very, very interesting questions. One of the things that Emma-Jane Westby has observed, she gave a core conversation at DrupalCon Austin I recommend everyone watch. It's on the danger of having no why.
I will link to that.
At some point, our mission statement shifted from build a product to be a community. And that means, in some ways, we lost focus on the user. Lost focus on what are we trying to accomplish. I would actually argue growing the community for the sake of growing the community is the wrong approach. If our goal is to build a world-class content management system or content management platform, then there are some places where community is not necessarily the answer to it. It's a part of it. But just saying throw more people at it and that's automatically a better community and a better product is not actually the right approach. And we need to have some hard conversations around, you know, are there parts of building Drupal, building the platform, that are better handled in a non-grassroots community fashion? Dries talked about some of this in his keynote this week. You know, we've always had the situation, like any project, where, you know, we've got 2,000 plus contributors to Drupal 8, which is enormous, but still 80%, 90% of the work is done by this, you know, 200 people.
Yeah, and we've had historically over and over again problems with burnout,
right.
problems with life priorities changing.
Right. And, you know, what Dries was talking about, we need steady resourcing. So how can we incentivize companies to pay people to work on core in large chunks, like weeks at a time, not hours here and there? That does change the dynamic. It might be if we make that change, Drupal 9, years down the line, has fewer contributors than Drupal 8. We should not automatically think that that's a negative.
Right.
It's not necessarily a bad thing if there's still a healthy community and a successful platform as a result. That said, I should talk about this more. At DrupalCon Denver, I don't remember who I was talking to, it was just someone I was hanging out with in the bar, made the comment that one of the things that makes Drupal so powerful and so special is we can disagree, we can argue, we can fight, you know, we can have different views, but at the end of the day, you know, the people you're dealing with when working on Drupal, their goal is to make life easier for somebody else. They may disagree about how to do that, they may disagree on what that means, but at the end of the day, our goal as the Drupal community is to make life easier for someone else using Drupal.
And that's a great why,
yeah.
by the way. The empowerment story, mm-hmm. giving the power of our technologies into the hands of the non...
Ter informatie, ik ga er ook nog eens van toneel uitschakelen.
The empowerment story, putting mm-hmm. these incredible technologies that we're able to manipulate mm-hmm. into the hands of people with other skill sets, with non-developer mm-hmm. skill sets who need... advocacy, who need communication, who need this sort of things to make the world a better place or a different place or to pay their rent.
Yeah.
Right.
And then, you know, we may disagree even which other people we're dealing with. And there may be at different levels, a lot of other different people. You know, I work mostly on core, not on contrib. So the other people I'm concerned about is making life easier for site builders, making life easier for module developers, making life easier for themers, making life easier for people who will use Drupal to do something. I don't personally deal with making life easier for person clicking buttons. You know, I'm not concerned with the content editor because I'm concerned with the people who are concerned with the content editor. But that kind of virtuous chain is part of why Drupal is so successful. And that's something we should make sure we don't ever lose. You know, that empathetic focus is so important to cultivate without it becoming cliche.
Yeah, and I think that the size of the community, mm-hmm. Of course it's pointless to just throw people at something, but if we include the other stuff that we've been talking about today, bringing people in the right way, lots of mentoring, lots of very, very mm-hmm. helpful, you know, the community is a very small percentage of core contributors and a larger small percentage of people who write module code and do all that sort of stuff. And a very, 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 very large number of people who can sling a little bit of code, who can manipulate a theme, who can build a site, who can run a business with it, right? And that's also community. So we have a lot of strata mm-hmm. to address. And there's right now I feel there's an incredible synergy and commonality of purpose. And I wouldn't mind seeing all of the strata grow in a healthy way. And Dries's keynote, I felt, mostly is trying to address the very hard mm-hmm. core contribution problem, right?
And I think that's valid, and it's also a good way to approach it, because you know, one of the talks I gave here at the conference on managing complexity, which is kind of a critique of the Drupal development process, one of the things I talk about there, and I'm quoting other people from the talk
at this point,
if you have something that's complex and you try and build on something that's complex, you inherit all of that complexity. If you have a weak foundation, you know, you build on top of it, there's a limit to what you can do. If you fix that foundation, if you make that lower level simpler and less coupled and higher quality, that ripples out through the entire rest of everything you build on top of it. And the analogy that I used for Drupal 7 to Drupal 8 back when we first started was, you know, our house is getting old, and you know, we've got some nice furniture, but the house is old, the foundation's cracking. So let's pick a foundation ready-made off the shelf called Symphony, or Symphony Components, build a new house on top of that that can be much taller, much more modern, better electrical wiring, and then move our furniture over.
Mm.
And to do that, you need to have a better foundation, and that ripples out through the whole system. So I think making sure that core is solid, making sure that core is architecturally clean, making sure that core is well maintained, has a ripple effect. You know, if core gets crappy, then modules, no matter how good a module they are hamstrung. And that means site builders are hamstrung, and that means end users are hamstrung. If core is rock solid and, you know, unit testable and clean and fast and powerful, that means modules could be solid and clean and powerful or crappy.
Right.
And then you can let, you know, evolution take its course there.
Sure.
And then that means site builders can build something that's clean on clean modules, on clean core. And that's how you get the really powerful end user experience. You need to have that whole pipeline. You need to be thinking in terms of, you know, how do we enable the next layer up rather than how do we just focus on the thing at the end?
Yeah. So once again, I feel that Drupal's really on the cutting edge, that we're trying to do some things that nobody else has quite managed yet. And so we get the, you know, we have the privilege of figuring mm-hmm. this out as we go, but
blessing and curse.
So the Linux answer, mm-hmm. which is the total professionalization of the contribution space, you know, 90-95% mm-hmm. of the contributions to Linux at this point are done by companies because they're using it to make embedded systems and mm-hmm. whatever it is that you do with Linux. And yet that doesn't work for us because of the nature of what we Drupal, because of what we do with Drupal. It's a much more varied and mm-hmm. sort of open kind of a set of applications that you mm-hmm. create with it. So I wonder how to get this compromise between highly professionalized, mm-hmm. very stable core and a thousand flowers blossoming, making, you know, my metaphors are completely mixed up now, but you know.
Like, I get what you're saying. And I think the key is to understand those different layers and the different things we need to do with them. Certainly being a module developer can be an on-ramp to being a core developer. I don't think we should ever get to a situation where 98% of core is professional development and people who are not paid full-time to work on it can't do it. I don't think that's a good thing. But if we can get, that core 10% that's doing 90% of the work anyway, if we can get them funded, or half of them funded, and a lot of what they're doing is helping to piece things apart so it's easier to work on just one piece of a system. It's more decoupled. That makes it easier for new contributors to find an on-ramp. And maybe become a paid developer later, maybe not, whatever. It also makes more power from modules, again, paid or not. Right now, I think more modules are funded than core at this point. But if we can make that more viable, then people can work on modules and have more power there, again, paid or unpaid. And to some extent, we can let that, just evolve and take its course naturally. But it comes down to having that well-planned, well-thought-out, distinction and layers of involvement and layers of complexity that we can separate out. And you're right, Linux's audience is companies that build products with it. The users of Linux, the kernel, are Red Hat, Google, IBM, Dell, and so on. The users of Drupal Core are Acquia, Palantir, Pantheon, Phase 2, Lullabot, Wonderkraut.
Followed by a couple thousand more companies.
Yeah, it's services companies that are doing, they're not building products, but they're doing client services. Client services is the backbone of the Drupal commercial ecosystem. Client services can't support the R&D department that product companies can. So, this is a lot of what Dries was talking about in his keynote. There's no natural incentive and no natural benefit to services companies to work on a shared resource the way that there is for product companies around Linux. So what can we do as a community? What can the Drupal Association do? What can we plan to shift that balance so that it does become economically viable for services companies to work on this shared resource in large chunks, not in haphazard bits and pieces? And that's a very important question, and I overall like his proposal. I think something like that is a good way forward because it creates a value to the shared resource that is more immediate.
Yeah. And at the new PHP World Conference?
The idea behind PHP World is rather than it being a conference for this project or that project or that project, or a conference for PHP people doing stuff with PHP, the language, it's very deliberately there's a Drupal track, there's a WordPress track, there's a Symfony track, there's a Zend track, there's a PHPBB track, or I don't know what the full list is, but it's getting people from different communities, from different islands, all together on the same island to exchange information as representatives of those different communities and continue that cross-pollination.
I think it's going to be a great
I'm looking forward to it. I've been pushing the whole get off the island thing for a while. I am far from the only person doing that. There have been a lot of people who have been working on this for a decade to shift PHP from, a bunch of little communities that don't talk to each other to a modern, collaborative, large ecosystem. And it really is paying off. I would say, where we started, Drupal 8 didn't cause it. I would say Drupal 8 is the poster child for it because we were the largest project to make this shift. And the largest project, one of the early projects to adopt Symfony components as a base without doing Symfony full stack. So in a lot of ways, we've legitimized this process. We didn't start it, but Drupal 8 is a major driver of it.
We're showing that it's working.
Yeah.
So one more shameless plug from my side. Larry has got a guest post on Acquia.com.
You should read stuff I write. Let's just go with that.
So there's a guest blog series on Acquia.com called The Future of PHP. Larry and a bunch of other very interesting PHP figures have contributed articles to it, a top 50 GitHub contributor, people talking about all sorts of technical and social aspects of PHP. It's pretty good reading. Find that on acqui.com. Larry, thank you again for taking the time to talk with me. I'm looking forward to seeing you so many times in the next 6 months or so.
Yeah, we'll be around a lot. I still spend a lot of time at conferences.
Yep, so. Yep. That and airplanes.
Yeah, those come together.
Thanks, Ben.
And cut.